Good morning, everyone, and let's begin with few slides where we see what is all this, right? So I've been going through all the questions that people have been raising. Much of them, or rather all of them, will be covered. Yeah, hi everybody. And how much time is required to learn AI, this and that, everything is going to be covered. Okay, so just give me around 30-40 minutes and it will become start, everything will start to become very clear. I promise you that. Okay. Now, as all of you rightly said, and everybody must have observed this, that there's a lot of confusion out there. Whenever you want to learn about something, specifically AI or machine learning, right? And whenever, let's say there's, okay, Srikant is saying my voice is low. Okay. Is my voice louder now? Or can you check the speaker or on your phone system, please? All right. So the biggest problem that I have seen, right, and I'm sure everybody will agree with me, is there is nothing structured available anywhere when you come to understanding data science, machine learning, artificial intelligence, deep learning. There are a lot of, right? Yeah, Rahul, hold on. We'll go through a nice visual journey. We'll interact, right? I'll be asking some very common questions, and you'll see by the end of 40-45 minutes, everything will become clear, right? So everybody just hold on to what is data science and machine learning and AI. I'm going to address all that. And let me now begin, because the problem is so much confusion. There's no clarity, no structure, what to do. Everybody is saying some or the other thing. Now, do you know what is that one thing that explains any concept to anybody in this world? What is that one thing required to explain most complex of the situations to anybody in this world? Could you guys tell me, please? People with different backgrounds. When I say different backgrounds, I mean different cultural background, different education background, different working background, right? So intelligence, logic, understanding, analogy, okay? So these are different ways. But the underlying fundamental is this, or rather, no, not even listening, right? Till you guys go through a bit about myself on the screen, the underlying most important thing is simplicity or common sense, right? And I'll tell you in a moment why. Read this quote, right? Very famous person, Albert Einstein, probably the most one of the most intelligent minds ever to be ever born, right? Now, I believe in this ideology or this methodology of training very deeply. My belief system is centered around the simple concept that if I can explain the most complex of the situations or the concepts to a five-year-old kid, right? Okay. Sorry, guys. Just hold on. Yeah, Rajdeep, there are more than... Anand, I'm not sure. How many participants do we have today? I can see that, but we are a lot, right? So that is why everybody is muted. All of you, if you speak, then it will not make sense. So for the time being, when we are going through this presentation, that is why everybody is muted. After that, if you have any specific questions, if the questions tab is not working for you, I can unmute you and we can discuss one-to-one. So just hold on, okay? Right. Everybody else can hear me. Soptik and Richik are saying that they cannot hear me. Can you guys hear me? Yeah, so everybody is, yeah. Yeah, Mayank, thanks. I have to focus on the concept rather than the chat. Yes, but again, all of you are here, have invested 1 hour. So I have to make it worth it, right? I cannot just ignore everybody. So as a trainer, that's my job. So I'll speed up a bit. So the entire concept or my training methodology what I believe is that if I can explain the most complex of the situations or the concepts to a 5-year-old kid, then and only then I can say that I've done a very good job. And that kid has to reciprocate back, probably choosing different words, but the same context, right? Then and only then my fundamentals are very clear. In order to do this, right, the only thing that is important is common sense. If the examples or the analogy or the understanding or logic, everything whatever you guys said is based on common sense, that then everybody can understand. And that is why I claim it right now, and I'll make a full circle to it later. Anybody can learn ML and AI, machine learning and artificial intelligence. Okay, and we'll see how. So let me start by asking a basic question. Humans are rational. Humans are not stupid. They are intelligent. Then why did AI actually come into this world? Okay. What would have happened that led to the evolution of AI? There must have been some issue. So this is a progression story that I have created to help everybody understand. Imagine the year. No, it has nothing to do with automation, Rishabh. Okay. Automation is not intelligent. So imagine the year 1552. Okay. There were kings and queens. Probably some East India Company was ruling or trying to rule somewhere. What would have been the most common type of businesses then? Let's say we'll take a very simple example of a provision store, right? So there would have been a sole proprietor in a provision store. He would have hired a helper guy, and he would have been selling what? Pulses, grams, wheat and rice and all such stuff. Okay. Now, one fine day, the sole proprietor got curious and he asked, okay, helper guy, tell me, how much did we sell yesterday? Now, the helper guy was very intelligent. He had a very strong memory, and he quickly said that, yes, okay, yesterday we sold around 500 rupees worth of goods. The owner was satisfied. He said, okay, no problem, right? And then slowly, 2-3 months passed by. It was summer earlier, and now it was fall. Winter started approaching. Now, during this winter approaching or this winter season, an interesting phenomena happened at the home of the owner. The family, the owner's family, started consuming more of wheat and less of rice. This used to happen every year. So this gave an idea to the owner, and he went back to the store and asked the helper guy, okay, can you tell me, in the past 3 months, how much rice have we been selling? Is it going down? People are asking more of wheat. Is something like this happening? This is, if you tell me this, then I'll be able to plan my inventory well, and I'll be able to make more money. Now, this time, it was very taxing, mentally taxing for the helper guy. He did not know the answer because it required calculation, right? And similar such questions started to be asked all around other provision stores. So what all these helper guys did was they got together and they built a very innovative and a very simple solution to it. What they did was they took a simple piece of paper and pen, and they started noting down everyday sales that John today probably bought wheat so much kg and so much rupees. That's it, right? They started noting down, and slowly, whenever the owners used to ask the questions, they used to answer. Everybody was happy. Then slowly the industrial revolution came around late 1700s. 1834 around Charles Babbage came in and gave the world the first computer. And then slowly and steadily the IT industry went up. Now what these IT guys, these computer guys did was they took this pen and paper thing and they digitized it. And thus they gave to the world something called as MIS. Or management information system. Okay. Now, going forward, please note that humans have one fundamental basic nature. We get bored, right? Boredom. We get bored very easily. So we buy a pair of denims, what, yesterday? And then in a month, it's like a normal situation for us. We are not excited about it anymore. So MIS came into the picture. The management was receiving all kinds of different charts and graphs and summaries and tables and everything, and everybody was very happy. Then this fundamental nature kicked in and the people got bored. So there were some intelligent bunch of people known as statisticians. They came in and they asked, okay, what's the problem? So the human said, well, fine, MIS is very good, doing very nice, gives us very intelligent insights, but it always talks about the past. What about the future? Can you tell us what is going to happen in the future? So the statistician said, yeah, no problem. Relax. We are very intelligent. We'll go back, research, and give something to you. So they went back, brainstormed, and something called as predictive analytics came into the picture. Okay. Now, again, everybody was happy. And then again, everybody was bored, right? Humans have this tendency of getting bored. So the statisticians came again and they asked the humans that, okay, what happened? What happened this time? Please tell me. So the human said, fine, predictive analytics gave us the future. MIS gives us the past. Present, we know. We don't want to worry about it. We know what situation we are into. Now, can you also tell me what should I do about the future? For example, if something bad is going to happen, how should I avoid it? Or if something amazing is going to happen, how do I leverage it? So the statisticians went back again, they brainstormed, and they gave something to the world called as prescriptive analytics. Now, mind you, the word prescriptive comes from the medical domain, prescription, right? So what is a prescription? When you go to a doctor, he gives you a piece of paper and writes something on it. What does that prescription do? That prescription serves the purpose of actually helping you in not making whatever condition you are into worse, or actually making it better. So that's why prescriptive analytics, right? Now, again, everybody was very happy. All optimizations and all prescriptive things started to happen. People started to make money. And then slowly again, once again, they got bored. Now, this time the statisticians were furious. They said, okay, we gave you so much nice things. What else do you want in this world? So the human said, fine, prescriptive is very good. Predictive is awesome. MIS is excellent. But there is a fundamental problem. Till this point of time, all the if-else conditions, all the different possible combinations, all the different scenarios have to be given by a human being. Let's take a very simple common sense example here. Imagine you are driving from your home to your office. You are driving a two-wheeler or a four-wheeler, doesn't matter, right? So you are driving. Now, there's a bus in front of you and you want to overtake that bus. So what do? You actually slide a little to the left, assess the gap. You know the condition of your vehicle. You know how much to accelerate. What is your brake condition of the vehicle? And then you decide whether you will be able to overtake it or not, right? Now, imagine this. What happens the moment you slide it left just to assess the gap? There's a loud honk from behind and continuous honk. That means somebody else is coming at a faster pace than you. What do? Ideally, you slide back into the lane and let that guy pass, right? So that is one scenario. What if you are wearing your favorite white shirt and the moment you slide it left to assess the gap, somebody is spitting from the bus? What if there is a cow 200 meters away from you running in your direction from the opposite side of the road? Right? We don't have yet considered what is your mood. What are you going to the office for? Are you in a rush? Do you have an early delivery? Do you have some pending work? Is your mood okay? Are you angry? Are you upset? Point is, there are so many different possible combinations or possibilities that a human mind cannot think of. Right? And that is what was the fundamental problem here. So the statisticians went back, researched a lot, and thus gave machine learning to the system or to the world. Right? So machine learning says, give me the data and tell me what do you want out of it. Do not tell me the rules. I will figure out the rules myself. Okay. Very simple common sense example about this is, all of you must have been to a restaurant, right? What happens when you go to a restaurant when you want to eat something? You simply tell the waiter what you want to have. That's it. You actually do not go into the kitchen and start telling the chef, okay, peel the onion, now cut it, heat some oil, fry the onions, put this and that, mix it, fry it, and then serve me. You don't tell that, right? Why? Because that is stupid. So this is the exact simple example of machine learning. You just tell the system, what output do you want? You do not go ahead and tell the rules like traditional programming. If this happens, do this. If this happens, do this. Else do this. You are not supposed to tell all this. This is machine learning. Okay. Now, again, the fundamental nature is not going to go away, right? So the people got bored out of machine learning also. So the statisticians this time came with a baseball bat. They said, okay, now you are behaving like a child. We gave you everything. There's nothing else to be created. What is the problem? And give a nice logical explanation, or you are going to get some nice beating now. So the human said, relax. We are not stupid. There is a problem with this. They asked, what? And the human said, machine learning is not intuitive in nature. Give me 10 seconds, guys, and we'll together derive what intuition is. Everybody knows, but we need to define it. Okay. So machine learning is not intuitive. That means it is only going to give examples or answers to the questions that it has already seen. Anything out of syllabus, it is not going to be able to answer. So the statisticians went back and marked these words. I'll make a full circle to it three slides later. The statisticians joined hands with computer scientists, biologists, and genetists. And therefore, artificial intelligence came into the world. Right? Now, all of this happened and the MIS guys got upset. Right? They took it very personal. They said, what we innovated, what we created, that pen and paper thing, and then digitized it. You guys took it and evolved something into very beautiful, and you forgot about us. We won't talk to you anymore. Right? So these big companies like Oracle, SAP, Salesforce, all these companies stepped in and they decorated MIS. When I say decorated, that means they gave some additional features, such as direct integration with the databases, interactive charts, and all such other things. And thus, MIS became business intelligence, or BI. So BI is just an evolved version of MIS, and it still talks about the past. Just reporting, nothing else. Okay. Now let's go ahead and actually see the fundamental of artificial intelligence, intuition. Imagine you are on a vacation, right? You are relaxed. You have some kids with you and you have some older people with you. So it's a family vacation kind of a thing. And you are just walking around in some woods, right? Some forest. And you come across such a bridge. Now, please answer me. Would you feel safe crossing this bridge? I know I'm asking redundant questions, but this is targeted somewhere. We will be deriving something. Okay. So why won't you feel safe crossing this bridge? It's risky. Okay. What else? Gaps. Okay. So Ishan, don't step on the gaps. Step where there are no gaps. What is the problem? Okay, it looks old and broken or would break. Okay. Now tell me this. Yes, of course, everybody's life is precious, right? Now tell me this. Do you guys have actually ever had this same experience of crossing over such a bridge and, God forbid, falling down and breaking your bones? So, if you did not have this experience, how do you know that this is risky? Yeah, so probably you have seen it in movies, you have heard it from somebody, some other people's experience, or probably you would have just seen some parts of, let's say, wood that was wet in the water for a long time, it becomes brittle, it breaks easily, something like that, right? Point is, this, guys, whatever you answered, is intuition. Machine learning here in this situation will say, I don't know. I will have to actually cross this bridge, and then I will tell you whether I will cross this bridge or not. I don't know. I'll have to try it first. And what you guys did was intelligence or intuition. This is intuition. Now, let me know if you agree with my definition of intuition. Okay. What I define intuition as is using useful and relevant information to estimate or predict about a situation for which we do not have a direct experience of. I will repeat. Using useful and relevant information to make an estimate or predict about a situation that we do not have a direct experience of. Does that make sense about intuition? Now, let me give you a very simple example, a common sense example of what is useful and relevant information. Many of you would know how to swim. For people who don't know how to swim, think of any other activity like playing cricket, lawn tennis, table tennis, basketball, shopping, watching movie, anything. Okay? Tell me this. Did at any point of time, when you were in that example of taking over a bus, you wanted to overtake a bus and driving, did at any point of time a thought or information related to swimming come into your mind? Like, while swimming, I do this, then probably I should do the same thing here. Does it ever happen even in your wildest dreams? No, it will never happen. Right? This is called relevant and useful information. You have that information, but that is not relevant and useful in this scenario. And that is what intuition is. And this is, guys, is the base of artificial intelligence. Okay, that is the difference between machine learning and artificial intelligence. Now, sure, Sushant, I'll repeat the example. Example is, you are riding from your home to your office, you are driving, and you want to overtake a bus that is in front of you, right? Now, do you know how to swim, Sushant? Okay, excellent. So when you want to overtake that bus, and when you are in the process of deciding whether I should overtake now or not, anything related to swimming comes into your head or not? That while swimming, if there is somebody doing something on the left side of you, you do this, then I should also do this. Or I'm supposed to stop my breath for 2 seconds and I'll be able to overtake, right? That's the example. So relevant and useful information. Now, let's look at one similar example. We all know the name of this fruit is apple, right? We have been taught since we were kids. Can you name this fruit for me? Yeah, so apple. Probably the state is rotten, but the fruit is still an apple. Yeah, dried apple, rotten apple, whatever, right? Now, again, the answer to the simple question here is intuition. The question was, how did you know? Right? You have never been trained on such image. You have never seen this exact same image. Even then, you were able to decide or come to a conclusion that, yes, this is still an apple, right? Now, imagine this, guys. You have 5,000 programmers available for you, and you want to make a system or a computer software that is able to recognize what an apple looks like. Okay, so what are those parameters that you will teach or ask the system to look at? Maybe shape, color, size, right? All these different parameters. Texture, maybe a little piece of branch hanging over the head, coming out of the head. Now, Let's say you put in 5,000 programmers and they came up with very nice combinations. All those combinations, if the color is this and the shape is this and this, this, whatever, all these different parameters they thought of, and you made a system. Now tell me this. What if I give the image of a half-cut apple? Is the algorithm or your system going to survive? No, it will fail. It will not recognize. What if I actually give, let's say, the image of a green apple, Macintosh apple from Canada? It will fail. Let's say I pick up an apple, actual apple, paint it black, and then click its photo and then give it to the system. Again, it will fail, right? Point is, no matter how many different combinations you guys can think, there is still one possibility, or there are few still possibilities in which your system will fail. And this is the problem with traditional programming. This is where machine learning is required. Now, guys, I'm going to give you an AI mantra. Always remember this throughout your life, whenever you are talking about AI, whenever you are speaking about, or let's say discussing, reading, whatever. Ask yourself this question. This is your mantra. How does a human baby learn? Okay. So how does a human baby learn? You have to ask this question. Now tell me this. Do you actually tell the human baby that, okay, look at the shape, look at the color, look at this, look at that, and then if this is red and with yellow dots, then it is an apple? No, that is stupid again. How do you train a human baby to learn what an apple looks like? You just show the image in a book that this is an apple. Look and learn. That's it. So the same ways, the computer also learns by looking at different images of an apple, right? So that's what intuition comes to. Now, I'll make a full circle to whatever I said about computer scientists and biologists and genetists. How do they fit in the picture? Understand something. The algorithm for artificial intelligence is neural networks. When you use neural networks, the methodology or the process through which the system learns is called deep learning. And it creates a system that is artificially intelligent, because humans are naturally intelligent, computer systems are man-made, and that is why it is called artificial intelligence. And this entire domain in which you apply scientific algorithms on data is called data science. And this is where, because AI actually and exactly replicates, mimics human brain, that is why statisticians needed computer scientists and genetists and biologists, because the algorithms named neural networks comes from the human brain neurons. You have neurons in your brains. And these algorithms exactly work as human brain does. And that is why they are so intelligent. Okay. Now, let me go ahead with reinforcement learning and deep learning are the same. Himadri, I'll answer this question in the end, if you don't mind. Actually, they are not exactly same, and actually they are not very different also. Okay. Right. So yes, I'll define it again. Oh, Rahul, what do you want me to define again? Exactly the entire thing. So machine learning is the system defining the rules, the logic, the pattern recognition by its own. When you add intuition into it, using relevant information to make an estimate or prediction about the situation of which there is no experience, direct experience, then it is artificial intelligence. You make the system artificially intelligent by a methodology or the process of deep learning, for which you use the algorithm neural networks, and this entire, all these things fall under the purview of data science, which means application of scientific algorithms on data. That's it. These are just fancy words, guys. Humans like to complicate things. They cannot think in very simplistic terms or common sense. Okay. Now, the IoT is a new buzzword. Okay. This is IoT. What does IoT say, guys, or Internet of Things? What does it say? It simply is a networking technique. Understand it from a very common sense and a fundamental perspective, right? It is a simple networking technique which says, if I can bring the data collected by two different devices or more different devices which are already connected to internet at a single platform, then I can create much more intelligent solutions. I'll give a very simple example. Now imagine the route that you take every day from your home to your office. There must be one traffic signal, one crossroad where you find a lot of traffic and you have to wait there at least once or twice. Okay, imagine that. Now there is a situation, one fine day you are in a rush, you are late for the office, you are at your home, you haven't left yet, and there is unfortunately an accident at that specific traffic signal, right? The traffic cam or that CCTV camera must have picked up that information or that data. Can I use that information to alert all the other users that there is an accident on this traffic signal here? Do not take this route, take another route. So what have I done? I've collected the data by the traffic signal or that CCTV camera and used it to alert the guys using smartphones who are yet to use this route or halfway on this route. Okay. So that is IoT. Okay. Now Anamika is saying storytelling has taken a lot of time. So Anamika, do you want to be the presenter? Would you like to tell it in your words? Right, I'll open up the platform for questions and please wait for your turn to ask questions. I'll be presenting as I feel correctly. So that's IoT, guys. Another buzzword that people have been hearing these days is blockchain, right? Now, blockchain, understand something. What is blockchain? Again, very simple. Use common sense, guys. Blockchain is the upgraded version of encryption. Swapthik, I'll relate IoT and blockchain together with AI. Hold on, in the very next slide. So blockchain is the upgraded version of encryption. Again, imagine the year 1552. If the king had to send a secret message written on a piece of paper to somebody, he would have encrypted it. What is encryption again? Very simple. Let's say I want to encrypt my name, Anurag, and I use the mathematical key plus 2. So A plus 2 gives me C, A, B, C, so C. N plus 2 gives me P, U plus 2 gives me W. So A and U becomes C, P, W, right? Now that C, P, W, unless somebody has that mathematical key to decode it, minus 2, that person cannot determine what this C, P, W means, correct? That is simply encryption. So that's where the SSL, 128-bit SSL encryption and 256-bit and everything came in. Now, blockchain says, do not just encrypt the file, encrypt the process also. So let's say you want to send a presentation to your reporting manager in your office. So what do? You first of all have to make that presentation. So you fire up PowerPoint, you open PowerPoint, right? That is encrypted. You start making the presentation, start typing, giving animations, that is encrypted. You save the file, that is encrypted. You open up your email, that is encrypted. Attach the presentation, that is encrypted. Send the email, that is encrypted. So blockchain is the encryption or process encryption methodology. Now, why do we need IoT and blockchain? Why these two things have come in? Because we are dealing with such huge amount of data. And it contains a lot of sensitive information, right? Because we contain this data contains a lot of sensitive information, and therefore security is required, and therefore blockchain exists. So IoT and blockchain basically are just the small, let's consider AI as the mainstream river. IoT and blockchain are just small waterfalls. Why do you need IoT, or why do you? What will you do after collecting the data and bringing them together from multiple devices? You have to use machine learning and AI algorithms. There's no other alternative. Okay. Blockchain for the security of data. That's it. So IoT will bring the data together. What do you do after bringing that data together? You apply ML and AI algorithms. That's it. Okay. Now, let me actually show you some real world examples what the world has been doing. Okay. Now, gone are those days when you used to talk about AI, and the first thing that used to come up was self-driving cars. Okay. Recently, around 2 months ago, you can just go to YouTube later after this webinar and search for Volvo self-recruiting car. Volvo has made this AI car. What this car does is it hires its own engineers by interviewing them at it, and it assesses the candidate on all those parameters on which a human being assesses a candidate. So whether the person is extrovert, introvert, loyal, team player, everything, right? Just watch this video. This is amazing. And yeah, here is the screen. Look at this, guys. So carefulness, extraversion, openness, emotional stability, service orientation, everything. Okay. Another AI application that one company has come up with. Read this, and this is a bit scary. New AI application can write its own code. Right? They're calling it Bayou, B-A-Y-O-U. Okay. And read this, guys. Studies millions of lines of human written Java code. It's basically studied everything on GitHub, and it draws on that to write its own code. Okay. So by the year 2025, imagine Java has been cracked up. So Java, HTML, CSS, PHP, Angular, Node.js, whatever coding language you can think of, no programmers required. System can write its own code now. Bye-bye. And since programmers, human programmers not required, therefore the machine does not make a mistake while writing those codes, and therefore QA is not required. Bye-bye. Right? And this is not just a theory. This was posted when? See, 2018, April 25th, almost more than 1.5 years ago. This company, engineer.ai, has actually implemented this. This company uses Natasha. They are calling it Natasha, their AI product. And Natasha actually makes Android and iOS applications, APKs and iOS applications, ready-made, delivered. The customer just has to tell what color does he want in the app, what the app features should be, and that's it, done. So the companies that used to charge $24,000-$25,000 for Android application and iOS applications, they charge $120. That's it. Imagine. Right? Now, having said all this, there are multiple, there are so many other examples, guys. AI has recently helped 3D printing enable. Did you know Israel has printed the world's first human heart, working human heart made from human tissues? AI enabled that. Okay. So there are so many multiple examples. Having said that, I'd like to show you the course that I have created. I and SFJ team have created this course. It is just a 60-hour course. So somebody who was asking how much time is required to learn AI, the answer is 60 hours, 6-0. 60 hours, short, crisp, professional, and to the point. We start with very simple examples, and common sense is throughout the training. Delve with all the jargons that are there, understand machine learning, use a lot of videos, lot of use cases, real world examples. I've been consulting on some seriously advanced AI projects that I'll be showing you, right? Then we'll do 10 projects on machine learning and 10 projects on artificial intelligence in this 60-hour course. So 20 projects, guys. Okay, we'll look at different algorithms. There are so many algorithms there. We'll look at 10 algorithms for machine learning. Then we move on to artificial intelligence. Oh, okay. There are some sounds. Hold on, guys. Yeah, sure. Somebody has unmuted themselves or what? I don't think so. It's clear?
It's okay. Totally fine, Anurag. There is no problem at all.
Oh, okay. I thought, yeah, all right, no problem. So after the machine learning, we delve into artificial intelligence. And trust me, guys, believe me, first I'll tell you why should you believe me. So let me show you the slide that I have, and I did not actually focus on this. This is a little bit about me. The advantage with me is, guys, I have seen this entire industry evolve right in front of me. I've been a part of this industry when it was MIS, then it became analytics, and then machine learning, and then AI. And that is why I can tell, I can explain all these concepts in very simple terms. Okay, so believe me when I say ML and AI go together. They cannot be two separate courses in this. Machine learning and AI will always go hand in hand. You cannot have two different courses for this. They have to be a part of one course only. Okay. Then we go out with fundamentals, neural networks, look at different recurrent neural networks, LSTM, CNNs, autoencoders, restricted Boltzmann machines, everything. Do 10 different projects. These are those 10 projects that we'll be doing. Apart from this, self-driving car and everything is also included. I've just not mentioned here, right? So how does a self-driving car actually work? You will actually make a soft version of self-driving car on your system. It will all happen on your system, right? Then how do you approach a machine learning project? How do you crack interviews? Various openings being shared with you with different locations, everything. Okay, so that's about the course. And now I'll open up the platform for questions that you guys have. Yes, of course, Reshma. Image recognition and object detection in live video feed, both are a part of this. Yes, prerequisite of the course, let me share with you guys. And it's actually self-understandable. The prerequisite of the course is this. Right? So I've been telling you guys, everything is common sense. See, understand something. We are talking about intelligence, and every human being is intelligent. So it cannot be very complicated. If it was very complicated, then very few human beings would have been intelligent. It's everything is just about common sense. If you understand common sense, that's it. Done. There's no other prerequisite. Okay.
Hi. Just one more query from one of our participants. That what is that they can expect as an end outcome of doing this course?
Okay, sure. Anshul, this course includes programming, but please understand, you do not have to have any programming background or technical background. I'll tell you why, and then I'll connect this answer with what you can expect out of this course. Please understand, as I said, the entire objective of machine learning and artificial intelligence coming to this world or get given to this world was, human beings cannot think of all the possible combinations or situations or possibilities. So there is actually no need for you to learn a script or a language. You will not be providing those logics. Coding is required, yes, because we are dealing with computers, but all those codes are already available on the internet. What you have to learn and understand is, how do you use, what code do you use, when do you use, and how to modify it as per your requirement. That's it. You don't have to be a programmer to learn artificial intelligence or machine learning. I myself am not a developer. I'm not even an engineer. I'm just a BBA and an MBA. If I can do it, anybody else can do it in this world. And as far as what to expect out of this course, very simple. After this course, you will be intermediate data scientists. Why am I saying intermediate? Let me explain. You will not be a fresher, because we'll be doing 20 projects. Why you will not be an expert? Because no training in this world can make anybody expert. It's only practice and a lot of experience that will make you expert. So you will be ending up with being intermediate data scientist. And it is not like you will be changing your career. This is what Anand initially said. It is upgrading of your skill. We had Nokia 6600 earlier. Smartphones came, we upgraded to that. It is just upgradation of your skills. And understand something, guys. Data is neutral, correct? When I say data is neutral, I mean data comes from any and every domain. Look at any company in wherever you work. HR department also generates data. Admin also generates data. Finance, sales, operations. Every department generates data. That is why data is neutral. And since data is neutral, AI and ML is also neutral. It is not industry specific. That only few industries can apply machine learning or AI. It is everywhere. So Sopthik is asking, is it really important to learn all the statistical concepts? Is it really? Yes, it is important, because the answer to your question lies in the answer to my question. My question is, what is statistics, right? If you understand what statistics is and what data is, that is where you will learn. And trust me, in my experience of 9 years, I haven't had one guy who has come up with the correct definition of data and statistics in the first attempt. Whatever explanations or definition you can give is definitely somewhere lacking. I'll not say completely wrong, but somewhere lacking. We cover all this in the first two sessions of the course. Okay. So Bhuvnesh is saying, my wife is homemaker. She takes care of our son. Can she take up this training? Of course, anybody can take up this training. I have trained, again, homemaker, not homemakers actually, but yes, I've trained candidates from HR department, human resource department, who are working with MNCs like Capgemini, and they are data scientists there. What can she do with this new technology? That actually depends. See, Bhuvnesh, we are talking about intelligence, right? So it is always dependent on your thinking, a candidate's thinking, what innovative solutions you can build. Anything and everything is possible, right? Certifications, yes, two certifications, one for the course, one for the projects. Rajdeep, yes, you can have it from Kolkata, you can have it from US. I have people getting trained from US and Singapore and multiple countries. So Kolkata is not a big problem, right? Nothing is a problem. We connect online just like this. We talk, you ask me questions, and it's more like a discussion oriented learning. It's not one way street where I just keep on presenting. Today's webinar was about sensitizing, and therefore it was one way. We opened up the platform in the last 10-15 minutes, so now it is two way. But learning during the classes is always discussion oriented. Cognitive services from AI. Again, Prashant, you'll have to fundamentally understand in very simple terms what is cognitive service. If you can define that, then you will automatically be able to differentiate what is AI and what is cognitive service. Yeah, Mega, data science is simply the application of scientific algorithms on data. Initially, it was called data analysis, then data mining, then data analytics, and now data science. It's one and the same thing. They have just changed the name. Okay. Or just for fun, let me ask you this. Do you guys know the difference between analysis and analytics? They are two different words, right? So there must be a difference. What is the difference between analysis and analytics? Please make an attempt. Yeah, so Ravi, managerial background. Understand something. Since you have a managerial background, or you are in that position, that means you are managing people. So you can be at a researcher position and AI researcher position, where you will be handling teams of data scientists and getting the projects delivered. Look at the screen. I had actually a lot of slides here, but it's not possible to cover everything in 1 hour. So this is the AI researcher, AI developer, and AI DBA. There are just three roles in artificial intelligence and machine learning or data science domain. Okay, just three. Different companies use different names for the designations that they want to give. Okay. If we learn all the statistics, then what do statisticians do? Okay. So Sopthik, when you learn statistics, you yourself are a statistician, right? You yourself become a statistician. And earlier it was up to the statisticians to make all those models and fine tune, and a lot of demand was there. But now machine learning has come, and therefore statisticians are now acting as coaches or trainers for the system. Just like any human being can be as intelligent as you want that human being to be, but still, when that human being is a baby, that baby needs to be taught, put up in school. So teachers are never going to go out of business, right? And therefore data scientists are teachers. Okay, so analysis is about finding root cause and analytics is about predicting. Not necessarily, Prashant. So analysis, okay, analytics, this and that, and okay. Guys, I'll tell you, it's actually very simple. Please use common sense. Analysis is the mathematical churning of data that we do, right? Plus, minus, or divide, or averages, and this and that. Analytics is simply the statistical analysis of data. That's it. Okay. The moment you start analyzing data using statistics, that's what analytics means. I told you, people use funny words. They just come up with complicated different jargons. That's it. Why AI coming into existence? Yeah, I just told you. Because machine learning was not intuitive. Human beings have another habit, right? Dependency. The more you help, the more dependent they get on you. Consider your office. Let's say you finished a task very early. Oh, great, you finished this task. Here's another one for you. That happens, right? So that's why people get bored and people are dependent. That's why AI. Okay,
Great.
so Joy has asked an interesting question. Like you said, MIS and predictive analytics got boring. Do you think AI won't? Yes, I think AI won't as in evolve into anything else. There's nothing, guys, coming after AI. This is the peak. Why? I'll tell you something. Or ask a very simple common sense question to yourself. Can you guys teach something to somebody that you yourself do not know? The answer is no. You cannot teach, right? So we also, human beings also, can only make the systems intelligent up to the level that we are intelligent to, right? So AI is not going anywhere. It is not going to evolve into anything else. This is the peak. Okay. Batches will be taken. Yeah, Tony, there are multiple trainers for artificial intelligence. I also take batches. There are other trainers that take batches. It's up to you. My batch is starting on 29th of June, Saturday and Sunday. It's a weekend, so for all those who are working professionals, no problem. Robotics, again, Ajit, robotics, what is robotics? Or let me refer to as RPA, right? Robotic Process Automation. Are you fine with RPA? That's what you are referring to, right? So RPA is not intelligent. This is stupid. RPA is just simply stupid. I'll tell you why. Right? Consider a warehouse where you have an RPA, you have programmatically made a robot pick up some stuff, a box from one location to put it at the other location. That is donkey's work. Just keep doing the same thing again and again. What if a human being jumps in the path of that robot? What will that robot do? It will simply stop. It will not do anything else. We are talking about intelligence. Creating solutions. Or what would you do if somebody is in your way? You would just go around that person. Or if you know that person, start talking, walk along, or do something, right? You'll not just simply stop and say nothing. So that's the difference between robotics, RPA. That is traditional programming. We are talking about intelligence. Data science course will be on R and Python only. No SAS and Statistica, because R and Python, first of all, are open source. Number two, they are very popular. Number three, they are very, very robust. SAS, Statistica, all are paid, and only 1% of the companies in the world are still using it. I don't know why. R and Python outperform every other software in the world. Plus, remember, machine learning is only executed on R, never on Python. And AI or deep learning is only executed on Python, never on R. Remember that. Yeah, Sunil, we will be working on R and Python, but you do not need to learn that. Okay, that is covered in the course, and you don't need to be a programmer to do that. Yes, hardware, ideal hardware that will be required or you should have for deep learning projects, because that is very heavy computing. That should be minimum i5 8th generation, minimum 8 GB of RAM, and a GPU. So NVIDIA GeForce GTX 1050 Ti or 1050 works. Right? That's the ideal configuration. But even if you have an i3 8th generation, 7th generation, and 4 gigs of RAM, you can still work on it. Not a problem. It will not hang or something, nothing great, but you'll not be able to use huge data sets. You don't have to actually have to learn anything for artificial intelligence. The sequence of learning artificial intelligence is first go through statistics, then machine learning, then AI. Everything is covered in the course. Yes, AI or deep learning, Tanushree, always has to be done in Python, and machine learning only in R, not the other way around. Reshma, understand something. The advantage of AI course is similar or same for every person, irrespective of the background, right? It's not different. We are talking about intelligence. Even if somebody is a developer, that person is still going to be the same at the end of the course in the caliber level, intelligence level, or knowledge level as compared to a non-techie person. The point is you don't have to look at it from a technical background advantage perspective. You have to look at it from advantage perspective. You are moving into AI domain now, and that is having so much of demand. You look at the salaries that people are getting, right? Devesh, understand something. Python is not statistics based. Machine learning is purely statistics based. There are multiple, let's say, tests and parameters that you have to look at when you are doing machine learning, and that only R reports. Python does not report them at all. No capability there. Okay. Since AI is computer science algorithm, that is why it is only done on Python, and machine learning is purely statistics based, and R is a statistical software. So that is why machine learning only on R. Yeah, sure. AI is actually disrupting a lot of industries. Every industry is getting affected by this. Slowly you'll see AI is going to get infused in our daily lives. Just keep an eye out for this. It's very interesting what people are doing, what companies are doing, what different applications are coming up with AI. Even if you don't want to get associated or enter this domain, learn this, not a problem, but it will be fun to keep an eye out, right? So all the best, guys. And do get in touch with me if you have any questions or you need some clarifications.